Been time without you.
Not that I missed you, or anything like that. I'm sure you missed me. All right, Mr. Manager, you want to begin?
Sure. Mr. Mayor and members of council, I believe we have somewhat of a short agenda today in terms of items, maybe not length. But what we'll do is we'll start off with turning it over to you, Mayor. I know that you have a meeting next week related to the Port Authority and the discussion of the payment in lieu of taxes. There are three items that are on the agenda for the night that Frank will discuss briefly. And then we have a real estate matter to go into closed session. And then we're prepared to provide you with an update on the conference center. I would like to, Mayor, make one introduction before I turn it back over to you. Last month, you may recall that we had a presentation by the Hampton Roads Community Foundation, Debbie DeCroce, and it was such a good presentation that we thought that it would be useful for us to steal one of her staff members. So I'd like to introduce to you today our newest assistant to the city manager, and that's Christine Morris. And she has worked for the Community Foundation for the last 9 years, most recently as a vice president for community initiatives. I think what's neat about it, Mayor, you may be very familiar, some of the lead projects that she's had as related to the Park Place initiative that we discussed last month, but also the early childhood initiatives such as the Smart Beginnings for Southampton Roads. I think some of the other things are pretty neat is that she's been working on regional collaborations in terms of workforce development and economic development. So I believe we have a jewel here. Two items that we've been working on for a while in terms of the City Council's priorities are lifelong learning and economic vitality and workforce development, as well as the whole conversation we've been having about the task force and our committee structure and things of that nature. And she has a wealth of knowledge in all of those areas. We're very pleased to have Christine support the team.
Great. Welcome aboard. We can use some help, so thanks. That's for sure. So can the manager. Just quickly, around the table, if anybody's got anything, we do have a long day, and if, unless it's something really pressing, maybe we could move on. Andy Barkley, you okay?
I'm going to try to pass along a letter. Someone sent me a picture of your garden planted herbicide at the cemetery.
Dr. Whitley?
Fine.
No. Mr. Burford? No.
We may be on to something, Evan. We
okay, Tommy, you got anything?
Well, real quickly, I just got an email. Dominion Power, where they're doing the transmission line replacement, they've taken out about somebody's estimated 300 to 500 trees. Some of them could be on city property that were planted on the medians. And just wondering if there will be any work on trying to replace some of the trees that have been removed, even if it's not in there. They have to by law to remove them, but if we can get an idea of how many trees have been removed and whether or not. I know your initiative, Mayor, with planting 20,000, was it 20?
Yeah.
20,000 trees. Well, right. We have a deficit now. We're going the wrong way. But we might want to look at trying to add some back in over on that side.
We had a presentation at Larchmont, and they actually talked about all the trees that the city's going to bring back in and size-appropriate trees.
Right, yeah.
So they won't have to undergo the brutal pruning that they do.
Right.
And they said at that time that if neighborhoods came and said they wanted the trees replanted and or removed
right.
and new ones put in, that
they would take
the
care
city
of,
would.
Oh, city would. Yeah. Okay. That's it.
Okay, just briefly, I've been asked to attend a meeting of Virginia Port Authority on Monday afternoon, and they have set aside 2 hours to talk about an issue which has been sort of a sore spot over here for a lot of years, involving the loss of tax revenue to the city of Norfolk that occurs because of the NIT being located in Norfolk, 648 quarter acres, I think. This issue goes back to the 80s, and then somewhere in the late 90s, we took the position as a city that the city of Norfolk underwent a burden for the operation of the Port of Virginia, unlike any other city in the Commonwealth, and we were disadvantaged because of it. Other cities, specifically Chesapeake and Virginia Beach, are the beneficiaries of the great amount of growth that occurs in the port, not Norfolk, not Portsmouth, not Newport News. Recently, if you read the newspapers about a wonderful announcement in Suffolk about a new $94 million development out there by Lipton Tea, they cited two reasons why they were going to stay at that location and reinvest. One of them was the proximity of the Port of Virginia, which is NIT. So, partly NIT. In the late 90s, the General Assembly, at our urging, asked Jay Lark to do a study about was it true that we were disproportionately burdened, and the answer that came back from the study, to everybody's surprise, was that the city of Norfolk was, as were the other host localities, but the city of Norfolk, because NIT is larger than both Portsmouth and the Norfolk and the Newport News facilities put together, we were the ones who were most disadvantaged. So the General Assembly actually passed a statutes with a formula that we all agreed to, but it was subject where they would send about $4.5 million a year to us. I think that's close to the number, but that was always subject to appropriation, and they never appropriated the money. Presently, we get a little over $1 million from, it's about $1,060,000 from the port. One is for a payment in lieu of taxes, and then there is a service fee for the fire and police that we provide. Together, it's a little over $1 million. During the course of the discussion about the privatizing of the port, it was clear that if the port were privatized, the city of Norfolk would get millions of dollars in additional revenue. A.P. Moeller, I think, took the position that it was about $8 million. That was their first out of the box. And in fact, we have a letter to that in that regard. The Secretary of Transportation actually wrote us another letter estimating that we might get as much as $15 million a year. And of course, that didn't occur. We actually had two bills in the General Assembly this year, one that Delegate Joanno carried asking for $1 million from the Port Authority. One that Senator Alexander carried asking for $5 million from the general fund. The Port Authority went up there and pretty much demanded that both bills be withdrawn. And they were. It's a reflex action on their part. They can't help themselves. I mean, that's been their position from the very beginning. Actually, the Maritime Association supports us. And so I'm going over there Monday, where they've set aside 2 hours. I think there are going to be a lot of people in the room. We have a lot of new Port Authority commissioners. This is a new issue to them. I've already spent about an hour and a half with the chairman of the Port Authority to talk to him about this. He's from Roanoke. This was new to him. He had received some briefings about it. So this will be the subject of a real push. We would hope that we could get the support of the Port Authority, that the General Assembly would actually fund this formula or bring it up to date. We know that the port decided not to privatize, not to accept the offers to privatize the port. And as a result, it cost us anywhere between $8 and $15 or $17 million, that decision. You know, and that was a conscious decision made on behalf of the port. And it came at our expense. And so we're going to use this as a club, if you will, to go to the General Assembly, to go to the governor, to go to everybody we can go to say it's about time Norfolk got treated fairly. And so that will be one of our, I hope, if you agree, one of our chief legislative initiatives come the next budget. We've got two people running for governor. We ought to have both of them on record that they will support this. Before we talk to them about anything else, this is the time to start you know, I mean, collecting those commitments before they actually get to the General Assembly in January. So we'll go to the existing, we go to Governor McDonald, we will talk to both of the candidates for governor, we will talk to as many members of the General Assembly as we can, as well as, you know, the Maritime Association has already agreed to support us in this effort. We would hope that the Port Authority will also support us. You know, I mean, if we could, I mean, that's millions of dollars in revenue that would, that goes right to our bottom line. We've just been denied. So anyway, that's what we'll, you know, we're going to start beating that drum pretty heavily at the beginning of Monday. Okay. And then, you know, we'll put up, like, Terry wants us to put up roadblocks on Hampton Boulevard to keep trucks from going down there. We'll just,
doesn't need
we'll
a roadblock, just a sign.
We'll just, the chief can go out there and enforce it. Okay, that's that. All right. Risk management, break.
Good luck.
No, we're, I mean, this pulled back this scab. When they started, when the Secretary of Transportation actually called me on the phone and said, you know, there's a guy over there working at BIT that makes more from the port than the city of Norfolk does. And I mean, that was embarrassing. I mean, that was, yeah, I mean, that was an in your face comment. So, I mean, I think we owe it to the community to do better.
Mr. Mayor, what we have for you today are three zoning cases that are going to be coming to you, two of which are fairly simple and one of which is very complicated. So let me walk through these simple ones first. The first of these is a request by Norfolk Building Corporation for a rezoning on Thomas Street. This is property. It's located in the Norvella Heights neighborhood, which is a neighborhood that is all single family homes. And it's immediately adjacent to the interstate where Iowa and Thomas come together. It's this parcel here that currently has one single family home on it. The request is to rezone the property from R7, which requires 6,000 square feet of lot area with 60-foot lot width, to conditional R9, which would allow two homes to be built on the property because it only would require 4,000 square feet of lot width. The way they are proposing to subdivide the property is to split it essentially down the middle with the two lots facing Iowa Street. Now, whenever we have a request to rezone property in an established neighborhood, what we are always looking at is what is the lotting pattern in the area. Is this consistent with what we see in the area? So in this case, what we looked at were the number of lots in the Norvella Heights area that are have less than 6,000 square feet and less than 60 square feet in width. And what we found is the overwhelming majority, 84%, are larger lots. Very few are smaller than that. And if you look on the block face where this would be located, none of them are smaller than 6,000 square feet. And you begin to get an idea of what this looks like if you begin to look at it graphically. We discounted all the property on the west side of the interstate. So what you're looking at is these properties. They are overwhelmingly larger lots than 6,000 than is proposed with the 4,000 square feet. And this is looking at the area. So if you look at the area, that is even more dramatic than if you look at the lot width, with 97% of the lots having the larger area. And this shows you graphically how that distributes. And you do see this is a neighborhood of fairly large lots. And for that reason, we can't recommend support of it. The applicant did propose that it would have two single-family homes. Well, that's all you'd be able to do with the zoning. So that's really not a proffer that's giving you anything you wouldn't get automatically. And he did indicate that the planning department would have approval of housing designs at the public hearing. The applicant spoke in support. Two neighbors came out and spoke in opposition because they did not want the additional house with the smaller lots. And so the planning commission, or staff's recommendation, was denial based on looking at the lotting pattern in the neighborhood. Planning Commission recommended approval on a 4-3 vote. The four who voted in support of this cited the need for more affordable housing in Norfolk, and they thought this would be a way to get additional affordable housing. The three opponents looked at the lotting pattern in the neighborhood and neighborhood opposition. And the people who voted in opposition to this were Mr. Fraley, Ms. Flood, and Mr. Law. that your ward?
Rovella Heights?
Yeah.
Have you looked at it? You have no opinion.
Accept your recommendation.
Whose recommendation?
Mr. Law, do you think he voted everything down?
Mr. recommended in favor of it. How about you, Angela?
That's what he says.
Angela, what do you think about it?
Oh, you said he.
I haven't seen it, so I couldn't tell. I haven't been out there to see it.
Well, go back.
So I really couldn't.
You're going to have to call this one back up. We haven't made the.
Join in, right?
Now, what we looked at, if you go to this slide, slide number eight. This is.
Yes.
So what you're looking at, what we always look at is lot width. We're looking at what is proposed and how that compares with what's in the neighborhood. So when you look at lot width, the overwhelming majority of lots in the neighborhood are 60 feet or larger in width. And so if you look at that graphically, the blue lots are those that are less than 60 feet in width. The yellow are 60 feet in width or more. And we also look at it in terms of lot area, because the requirement right now is 6,000 square feet. So we're looking at what's the pattern here. 97% of the lots in this area are greater than 6,000 square feet. So this is a neighborhood with large lots. And you see that graphically here. When you look at how few parcels are in blue, again, the blue are those that have less than 6,000 square feet. We discounted everything on the west side of the interstate.
What's the average age of the homes in that neighborhood?
I don't know.
Okay. Are they ranch or two-story?
Most of them are ranch.
1960s.
I was going to say 60s and 70s would be my guess.
Those one above the interstates are pretty new.
There's some new construction. They have larger lots in that area.
Yeah, those are two-story back there.
So what about the general plan?
The general plan would support either of these, because the general plan indicates this is an area with single-family suburban, so what you'd be looking at would be a fairly large lot, but you're looking at single-family housing. So the general plan will support either of these.
What's the average assessment in the area?
I have no idea, because we're not supposed to look at property value. Zoning is not supposed to be focused on value. Use.
But they use the reason of affordable homes.
That was
so
the
I'm
reason.
So I'm trying to, I mean, what?
Because the
it's
applicant.
A good question.
Yeah, I mean, really.
That she's got a good question. If they're going to rely on affordable homes.
Right. Then they've looked at the value. Somebody has looked at the value of the properties and then looked at the potential value for this property and whether this property is going to increase or decrease the value of the homes around it.
They didn't even look at that. What they looked at with this is the applicant indicated.
That you know of.
I know they didn't.
Okay.
Because what happened was the applicant said that, and he's absolutely correct, that the largest single factor in housing cost is land value. And what he said is he could put two houses on this. He could do something more affordable than if he only did one.
Okay.
And they said.
Frank, and that's true.
That is true.
That is true.
So clarify again for me, you just said that the general plan is it's a suburban design. So a suburban design seems like that would be a larger lot size.
Suburban, it would, but either of these would be consistent with what that's calling for because it's single family.
So what was the argument for the people that voted for it when it wasn't consistent with the neighborhood, the planning?
The idea that we need to provide for more affordable housing, the applicant said if he could divide it, he could put two houses on that, and those would be less costly to the potential buyer than if he did one house on a larger lot.
And that goes back to the question of value, though. Because
he could make more money. Yeah,
so
there
you go.
But I agree. I'm just telling you this is what Planning Commission said. But we would still recommend denial because it is out of keeping with the pattern. And there is no active civic league here, so all we had were two neighbors who came out in opposition to it.
And what were the neighbors' reasons for opposition?
They did not want any more traffic than they had had with the, previously with the single house that was there. It's only 10 more trips a day, but they said they have a very quiet neighborhood. And they also don't like the idea of the houses potentially backing up and creating more backyard space adjacent to.
But there's no access out. That's the end of the road, isn't it?
The only way in and out is
the interstate.
Back out.
Yeah.
So this becomes the issue. Now, you do have Thomas that comes out this way, so you could go back out Texas Street or come back up to Novella. But you've got very limited ways in and out because you have no movement to the west here. Everything has got to go east.
So what do they propose happens to that lot? Did it just stay vacant?
No, that it be that you put one single family house on it because that's what is on the property right now. There's one single family house on it.
Those are big lots.
They are very large lots. This is an area, one of the areas of the city where we have larger lots than elsewhere in the city.
And there's a, I take it that's as we're coming up to Norview Avenue, and there's a, if I remember correctly, there's a barrier wall.
There is. That's what the shadow is the sound wall, keeping you from being able to see clearly the street. Yes, there is a barrier.
I'm fine.
You what?
I'm fine.
Yeah. Fine for it or fine against it?
For it.
How about you, Andy?
I'd like to know what the average age of the homes are, and I'd like to know what the average assessment is.
Some of those houses back
just
there
on the East Beach, they don't have any lots.
All right, everybody's fine. You ready to move on?
Yeah, we're moving on.
We're not deciding it
right now.
I don't think it was.
But we won't talk about that because it's relevant in terms of preference.
I'm late enough, so I just wait to see what they do.
I'm good.
She's good. Yeah. Anthony's good. All right.
Okay. Real estate,
The next one we have is a request
on the top of the drive. If you want to.
From J. Maynard Construction to develop a single-family home on a non-standard lot in the Fairmont Park neighborhood on St. Denis. This is the lot. It has had a house on it in the past. This is a neighborhood of single-family homes. What they want to do is a two-story single-family home on a non-standard lot. And the reason it is non-standard, again, is it is narrower than the required lot size. In this case, this lot is 33 feet wide. The zoning would require 50 feet of width.
Was there a house on it before?
Yes.
Okay.
This is the house that Mr. Maynard would like to put on the property. He came in and applied for the zoning certificate. But if you'll remember, your process says if you're going to build something that conforms to the character of the neighborhood in terms of setbacks, height, openings, porches, slope of the roof, then you can do that by right just getting the zoning certificate. The zoning certificate was denied in this case because what he wants is a two-story home in an area where there are no two-story homes. And so what you see here is that in this area, 22 or 88% of the homes are single-story. The other 12% are one-and-a-half story. There are no two-story homes in the neighborhood.
What was there?
Single-story.
Single, how many square feet?
I don't know.
Come on, Frank. How you gonna bring real estate stuff and not know real estate?
Because we're talking not real estate, but zoning, which is regulatory, and it doesn't get into that issue.
Say no.
You mean I don't know?
At this particular application or the public hearing, the only proponent was the applicant. The Fairmont Park Civic League came out in opposition to this. They have indicated they would support a home that was consistent with the character of the neighborhood, but they don't want to do something that is out of character with the neighborhood. And so we are recommending denial because it is out of character with the neighborhood. And the Planning Commission also voted unanimously to recommend denial because it is out of character with the neighborhood, and the neighborhood is opposed to doing something that is out of character.
Okay, so the lot is narrow, but it's deep?
It's deep.
It is deep. So they could do one story, just
yes.
it would just be a long house.
Yes.
It'd be probably laid out. Could they put an entrance on the side?
No.
Okay.
Because one of the requirements for the non-standard lot homes that are approved with the development certificate, you could put an entrance on the side if the other homes in the area that we're looking at have entrances on the side. What you're looking at is trying to maintain the character of the area.
And I take it there's no driveway space.
There, this would not allow driveway.
That does not have driveway space.
No.
Yeah.
Which is also the character of the area. The issue
that's
here was the height of the building.
Yeah.
That developer, Jay Maynard, is finding all the little lots like this.
Yeah. Approved one.
We've done a couple.
We've done a couple for him.
On behalf of the Civic League, did, what's his name, come down?
Taylor?
Taylor.
He did not come down. He sent me a letter. He communicated with me. He was copying the vice mayor on his letter that they had specifically unanimously voted to oppose it. He is going to be sending council a letter expressing the Civic League's opposition. And he indicated to Mr. Maynard that they would support anything he did that was in keeping with the character of the neighborhood, but they would not support doing something that would alter the character of the neighborhood.
Okay. All right. Are we ready?
And those are the two easy ones. Then we get to the hard one, which is unique auto designs. This is a request. It's the first request you've had to amend Plan Offer 2030, which you adopted last week. It's a request for a plan amendment, a rezoning, and two special exceptions, one for auto sales and one for auto repair. Property is at the corner of Colonial and West 24th. This is in the Park Place neighborhood. It's these three parcels right here. The area in which it is located is primarily industrial. There is a limited amount of commercial that's beginning to come up Colonial, which is something that the Park Place neighborhood is excited about and wants to encourage. And what the applicant wants to do is do auto, they're currently doing auto repair on this back portion. They want to bring that into conformity by getting the special exception and providing landscaping, and then they want to do auto sales on the front portion of the property. Plan Novik 2030, as you asked, the Planning Commission looked at this area in detail. And what they came to the conclusion after meeting with representatives of Park Place is that it would be a good idea to look at transitioning the Colonial frontage from industrial to commercial to help create a walkable corridor between Park Place and Ghent. And so the neighborhood is fine with that. So the plan does call for the property that fronts on Colonial to be commercial, but it also said we need to protect the industrial properties that are behind that, tucked away behind it, because we don't have a lot of industrial property in the city, and this they thought was a good place to keep some of our industrial property. The requested rezoning is to take the entire parcel, all three properties, and rezone them from light industrial to commercial. And the reason for that is you have to have all three parcels together to get a half acre of land, and you have to have a half acre of land to do auto sales by code, which is where this begins to get a little bit of a bit complicated. So what you've got is, unless you approve plan amendment and the rezoning, you're not able to approve the special exception for auto sales, because they need the entire parcel to be commercial to do that. So at the public hearing, the only proponent was the applicant. The opponents were the Park Place Civic League, and the opponents in, or the Park Place Civic League indicated they supported the commercial on the Colonial frontage. They did not like the idea of extending the commercial down 24th Street, and they are vehemently opposed to auto sales on this corridor. So, on the plan amendment, staff recommended denial based on having just looked at this area in detail as part of Plan Offer 2030 and the desire to protect the industrial properties. The Planning Commission agreed, but they also noted the neighborhood opposition and their unanimous vote to recommend denial. For the rezoning, we recommended denial based on the inconsistency with Plan Offer 2030. If the plan amendment is not approved, Planning Commission unanimously did the exact same thing, except they also noted the opposition of the neighborhood. On the special exception for auto sales, we're recommending denial based on the recommended denial of the plan amendment and the rezoning. Planning Commission did the exact same thing, adding in the opposition of the neighborhood. And then on auto repair, we're recommending approval because that would bring this non-conforming use into conformity with our ordinance, and we would get some landscaping improvements on it. Planning Commission also recommended approval by a 5-1 vote,
for those same reasons. The one person who voted in opposition was Mr. Thomas, and his issue was he didn't think we should be encouraging any auto-related uses in this area.
But it's already there, though, right?
Correct.
So all we're really doing is making them conforming.
Correct.
Making what they're doing currently conform to...
And we get some landscape improvements, which is why we would recommend the special exception for auto repair.
And that would be for this location, not in general?
Would only be for the for the property that fronts on 24th Street. That would not cover the property that fronts on Columbia. So it would have no impact on being able to maintain or to create and maintain a commercial corridor on Colonial, which is what the neighborhood wants. I will acknowledge that staff could support the rezoning of the property on Colonial to commercial, but not the property down 24th Street. We've recommended denial because what the applicant asked for was to rezone all three parcels, and we can't support the parcels in front on 24th as opposed to Colonial. And no, I don't know the land values here either.
Very funny, Frank. All right.
Thank you.
Are we done?
Good job. Okay, we're going to go into closed session, but I thought I'd pass around the letter. I've talked about the port, the payment in lieu of taxes or the service fees. Sometimes the terms are used interchangeably. But here's a letter that I got on September 17th, or at least it's dated September 17th, from the Secretary of Transportation that was sent to the mayor's. Just, I mean, take a look when you get a minute, but back on page 5, they calculate what he calls annual potential additional revenue if the privatization went forward. And for Norfolk, you'll see a $15 million figure at the very back page. They roll that stuff up. That's without business and professional license tax being calculated in there, which I think would be substantial. It could take the thing up to the 17 or 18 million. So there's real money out. I mean, real money. I mean, that's 10 cents on your tax rate.
So,
yes.
I move the members of council assembly closed meeting on April 2, 2013 at 2:40 p.m. for the purpose set out in Clause 3 of Section 2.2-3711 of the Freedom of Information Act. That is the discussion.
Distance from like 50% or so or more of the population of the beach can now access the light rail if this happens. And I understand that financing is largely, there will not be federal financing, that there will be city, state financing plus the other private piece, so they don't have to wait for the federal to get in line with the other pieces. So this thing could move pretty quickly here, which would be great for all of us. Support our conference.
It'd be great.
It'd be great.
Transit oriented development.
That's right.
That's right.
That's. I like that.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
Go eat at the restaurants in Virginia Beach then. Great.
Great. Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. We have a brief discussion today or presentation that deals with the Hotel Conference Center. Really, the purpose of this discussion is to connect from where we are today from where we were when we signed the letter of intent, as well as the press conference that occurred on the 1st of March. There's no council action required at this time. I think the best way to approach this is to just give you an update from the last time that we discussed the hotel conference center, which was at the end of January. The bottom line is that this is very, very similar to the previous deals that were presented to council, I guess, since 2005. In this particular deal, we have that the city provides funds for the conference center, the as well as the parking facility, and we have the developer who would construct the hotel. I'll go into all the details of how the funding works, but before then, I would like to mention some things that have always been a part of this project. One has been the $7.5 million grant that's provided to the hotel to reduce the cost of construction. That's nothing new, as well as the $750,000 performance-based grant for a restaurant, which will be paid over time. I think the two key components that are somewhat different than the last amendment, which may have been Amendment 5 a few years ago, is this concept of a tourism development grant. It's truly a public-private partnership where the developer, the locality, and the state all participate. In this tourism development grant, which is really created to meet any type of financing gap in a project such as this, there are some things that would have to occur from the local level, and that would be that the city would establish a tourism zone, adopt a ordinance that would establish the tourism plan, and then the state controller will certify any funds that come about from this. There are really three pieces. There is a 1% that the developer contributes, there's a 1% recapture of the state sales tax, and there's 1% a recapture of a local sales tax, which I would call a but-for tax. In other words, without the building, the tax would not exist, and it's only for what's collected in the building. I think it's very important to also tell you that we also have, as a part of this project, a public facilities grant from the Commonwealth, where there is a recapture of the 2-cent state sales tax, so it's a little north of that. But that is a sales tax recapture that would not come to the city under any circumstance. But the dollars that are generated in the public facilities portion of this particular project would benefit from that public facilities grant. So there's a public facilities grant, which helps us in terms of the conference center, as well as there is a tourism development grant, which will help the developer in terms of the hotel. And I think that's very important to put that out. The other piece that we talked a little bit about in January is that this project has had many iterations. And I think the best way to look at the project is really the 2008 version versus the 2010 version. The 2008 version was a hotel conference center that, I don't know the best way to describe it, but it was something that aspirational, if I can put it that way. And in order to try to make it work over time, things changed, and it became smaller ballrooms, smaller footprint, or redesigns that would save money, and we had a 2010 version. I will say that because it seems that what's best for both for the city for this project is to be closer to the 2008 version, which had amenities that I think we all can be proud of, as well as a very technologically advanced hotel conference center. The city's contribution, or the share of that, to get back to that version, is about $2.5 million. So in a nutshell, what you have is the project that has been discussed for some time, a number of years, which has two elements. One being this tourism development grant, which is a partnership between the developer, the locality, and the state, as well as an evaluation of the cost of the project, getting something that we all can be proud of, which would have about a $2.5 million contribution from the city that's on top of what we discussed earlier. But I do want to spend some time on the development budget, and I think there's been a lot of discussion about different pieces of this. What's the city's contribution, whether $70 million or $42.5 million. And I think the best way to do it is start off with this pie chart. I want to start off by saying that the parking component of it is about $19.5 million. But just as we discuss our FY 2013 budget, which is a $799 million budget just on the general fund. We go north of a billion when you start to put water in there and parking facilities and some of all of our special funds. But the parking fund is really a system with over 19,000 spaces and a number of garages. I believe we have about 15 garages and nine lots. And it works as a system. The revenue generated from the parking fund pays for all of our parking facilities, as would it pay for this parking facility as a part of this project. And that's very important. That's no new money from the city. There's no taxpayer support on this. This is a user fee. This is a user fee facility. So when you pay for the parking, that's what's going to pay for this component. So that $19.5 million in a parking facility is paid for by the users. The public investment, I think, is the important piece that we've talked about for a while in this public amenities fund. And I'll talk about that in the following slide, but I will say that on the private investment side, that $64 million, those are funds that are coming from the developer. So let's spend a little bit of time on the public investment, that $42.5 million conference center. Since 2003, the city has had a public amenities fund, and that fund is supported by a 1% increase that occurred back in 2003 on the meals tax and a 1% increase on the hotel tax. So to put this in perspective, you have a hotel tax of 8%. 1% of that never makes it to the general fund. It goes into this public amenities fund. The meals tax is about 6.5%. Only 5.5% of that goes into the, only 5.5 cents of the meals tax goes into the general fund. That other 1% goes into the public amenities fund. So for over, for about a decade, this fund has collected about $56 million between that 1% from the hotels and that 1% from the meals tax. And again, never being a part of your general fund. Since that time, we've been able to have enough money to support this conference center portion of the project. So again, the hotel portion is paid for by the private sector. The parking facility is paid for by user fees, and whatever impact that we would have on the general fund comes from the conference center portion, which in this graph is showing that it is paid for by the public amenities fund. There have been questions about debt service and our debt authority and constraints and issues. I will tell you that neither the parking facility, which is going to be paid for by the users, nor will the conference center, which is going to be paid for by the public amenities fund, is going to be a drag on our debt capacity. In other words, it will not be a drag on our ability to build schools or to pave roads. The public amenities fund, again, no new money for the conference center. The next slide talks a little bit about what's in the fund and what's happened over the last decade. About $56 million. It's important to note that roughly $29 million of that has been set aside for the conference center. Some of it has been spent, and some is still available. About $9 million has been spent, which leaves you with about $19.7 million in cash. It's available for this hotel, for the conference center portion of the project. We don't spend enough time, I think, talking a bit about the public amenities fund and the good that it's done over this last decade. In that little yellow box, it talks about the hotel conference center expenses, but the boxes above that include almost $11 million in scope improvements. We used to have tourist opportunity grants over the years, which would go to different organizations. I think at some point you even had WHRO that benefited from the public amenities fund in terms of these tourism opportunity grants. So a lot of good has come from the fund that is not necessarily just associated with the hotel conference center. So the fund balance, we talked a little bit about that in the previous slide, but basically that $29 million that has been set aside for the conference center, about $9 million has been spent, which leaves you a balance of about $19.7 million just in the public amenities fund. There were other dollars spent from the general capital as it relates to preparing the site and getting ready for this day. So you've heard that the total $16 million. That's an accurate number. The concept that just $9 million of that has come from the Public Amenities Fund, and the other component that has come from general capital. Okay, so the why. Over time, we've discussed this hotel conference center, and I think there are really three important points to bring out today. One is that it's very important for us to diversify our economy, and this hotel conference center has never been a standalone project. It's been a part of a bigger strategy, which benefits the entire city. What's also important is that it's very clear that market research has indicated that this is an attractive designation, and this particular conference center of this size will help us penetrate a niche that we've not been able to penetrate. And lastly, and probably the most important bullet on this slide, is that it's always been a part of an overall strategy. That includes the renewed efforts at Waterside, the marina, it's Granby Street, it is what's happening at the mall. It's everything that benefits the city when it comes to cultural venues and as well as cultural attractions. Diversifying the economy, so I'll hit on these three points very quickly. It's very important that if you go back to the State of the Region report from ODU in 2011 and in 2012, in 2011, it was very clear that tourism is one of the region's economic kingpins. In other words, that this is something in terms of when we look to diversify our economy, from Williamsburg all the way down to Virginia Beach, tourism is very important to this region, and we should capitalize on that. But also, in the latest State of the Region report from ODU, it was very clear that the region depends on Department of Defense spending to a great extent. Almost 46% of all of the regional economic activity is related to Department of Defense spending. So for those two reasons, diversifying our economy are extremely important. Employment, while we don't have the same kind of collection of data with the economy on the local level, we can tell you about our employment base. We don't have a sector of Norfolk's employment base that's more than 17%, and that's very important. So we believe that this is the right time, with everything that's going on in the economy, for us to focus on diversifying our economy. Norfolk's also an attractive market. I think there are two very important points that may have gotten lost in this discussion or previous discussions, is that in 2004, the city did engage the strategic advisory group to figure out what's the right niche for the city in terms of a hotel conference center. It was very clear not to overbuild it, not to have a large convention center that competes with, let's say, Virginia Beach or Hampton. But there's a niche. There's something special about this waterfront. It's something special about being the cultural hub for the people say the region, I say the Commonwealth, and there's something about the amenities that we have here that can allow us to penetrate a market that up until this point we've not been able to penetrate. What's extremely important is that we went back to the same group in 2012 and asked whether or not the dynamics of 2004 still exist today, and is this still a good project, and they said absolutely. Cross-marketing is extremely important. Again, as I mentioned, this is clearly not a standalone project. I think Councilman Protegero has said this for a while, that they all work together, whether it's Waterside, whether it's Granby Street, what have you. But it's also important that everybody's on the same page with that. We have a lot of great partners that work together well and create a product that I believe is going to benefit this hotel conference center project. So a little bit about the project overview, and we've had this discussion before. It's a 50,000 square feet of conference center space, 300 key full service hotel. It's very important, a full service hotel. 600 parking spaces, a high end restaurant, and the highest certification when it comes to this particular design. Again, the parking is paid for by user fees. The conference center is paid for by this Public Amenities Fund. after all of that, the projections that there would be $2 million of direct revenue spinoff beginning the first year. Okay, and that's going to grow each year. So $2 million of direct revenue, those are things that we can collect, whether it's real estate or whether it's sales tax. But that doesn't begin to describe the indirect revenue that's going to be a part of a project like this, as well as the other projects that are going on to include Waterside. So moving forward, this is the update. I'm asking that we have a public hearing scheduled for next week, which would include a council vote and any information that you need for that time. Our staff stands ready to provide that to you to prepare you for the 9th, if that works for the council.
All right,
good
thank
job,
you.
Mr. Randall.
Good job.
Yes, good job. No. Nice job. That's great. Okay.
All right.
Is there another agenda item other than, I want to talk about the school board meeting for a second. We invited the school board to meet with us today, actually, and I got a phone call from Dr. Houston saying they could not meet today, that just didn't work for the majority of the school board. They suggested getting together at another date. The 9th was one date that they offered. The 9th would be a night meeting next week, and whereas we know we're going to have plenty on our calendar. I don't want to get in a situation, you know, Terry, where we're hurried with them. What if we offer them the following? I know you're going to make your budget presentation the following Tuesday, but after you make the presentation, we could meet. I'd like to meet on an afternoon with them. Does that make sense to me to try to meet on the 16th or the, is that okay, Terry? Is that all
right? What, when do you do the budget presentation?
The 16th,
right? 16th. I mean, what time?
2 o'clock. We're going to go upstairs in the council chambers and he'll make it to everybody. Then we can go down here. We can push it off another couple of weeks.
We don't have a formal meeting on the 16th.
Well, I think we better meet with them while we can, because if we meet with them 16th, then okay.
Let's do it on the 16th. You'll make what we'll do at 2 o'clock. Everyone will come upstairs, and we'll be prepared for the budget presentation, and then you'll make that, and then we'll come down here and meet with the school board, and. By that time, we'll have seen what the manager proposes, and we'll know what the school board has proposed, and we can have a conversation here about, you know, looks to me like the school board's going to ask for an additional, what's it,
$7 million.
$7 million over and above what the original thought was. But maybe in 2 weeks, we'll have some better idea about where state money might be and where our budget money might be. And the last time we did this, the schools actually had a few more dollars to roll over. We closed the gap. Mm-hmm. You know, the goal was to close the gap here. I mean, that's for sure. Okay, to get where they want to be. So.
And the 9th is not good because?
It's a night meeting. We're also going to have this conference center thing here. It's next week. If people want to come in on the 9th, that's fine. What we sometimes bump up against is we don't have, and a discussion about their budget and our budget could take a while. So why don't we try the 16th, okay? All right? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And I would let them know right away, okay?
So they're running out.
We'll meet them here, you know, at 3:00, 2:45. Yeah, they can come to the budget presentation, then they can walk downstairs. All right. Okay. Thanks for the hard work today, Mr. Manager. I know you've had your plate full.
Thanks.
All right.